Howdy.
Howdy.
Thank y'all for coming out here. Did anybody get lost? How many weeks have you been working for TEEX? You get any? Before we get started, I'm going to hand this over to Michael Riggs. He's going to kind of walk us through the building we're in and welcome to the EOTT.
Howdy, everyone.
Howdy.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Michael Riggs. I am an agency instructor and an expert on it. And I am pretty much housed on the other end of the building. What we're in now is what we call the preparedness side. So this is where our enterprise classes take place. You see around me, you see some of them set up for some very exciting virtual reality things that we also have going on. I assist a lot of times in the class that goes on over here, a little bit of facilitation. On the other side, though, my main gig, if you will, is the enhanced program, where I'm the lead facilitator and instructor for our enhanced program, which is which is our grant funding for some of the National Defense Preparedness Consortium. I won't go into detail then because I don't want to talk a lot on management and stuff. But we have been here for a while. We do offer a wide range of courses here. What we do here, a lot of the programs in this building are what I like, I deem our domestic preparedness. So if there's a major event that goes on for a length of period of time, or what we call multi-operational periods, we'll have everyone on the team and we'll be able to work together in what we call silo escalation, bringing everything back together. So, for instance, your events that anybody see what's been going on in like Morocco or Maui here in Heather Lake, those are what we call multi operational periods. You're going to have boots on the ground for a long period of time and you want everybody working on the same page. Before coming here, I was born and raised in Birmingham, Alabama, which is a little bit about myself. Firefighter there for just over 20 years, the last four of which I was a training officer. While I was there, I came out and I took the enhanced program course. That's where the bug had been. I thought this place is amazing. And when I got the opportunity to put in an application, it was really just a long shot. It's like, okay, I'll just practice putting in applications then. There's no way. And, you know, thank God, I'm very glad they did. I've been very fortunate to stand up in front of many people and train them to be able to prepare, to be able and prepared to stand up for those type three events. So, again, we have other courses here. There are other stakeholders involved, and there are other programs here as well. And you guys are making me hungry. But we are all housed here. We all work together. A lot of times we have road courses and those people are out on the road and they're telling them about our residential courses here. And while we're here, we have about 45 minutes per class. We tell them about our road courses because it involves all stakeholders. We need a village to restore the village when something like that happens. But that's a little bit about me. That's a little bit about this building. We are so thankful and glad you all here. Welcome to the EOTC, the Emergency Operations Training Center. We love to share our facilities with people when they come in, especially when they bring food. And hopefully you all will have an excellent time. If you need anything, just don't hesitate to let me know what it is I can say to help. Y'all have a great time.
So I know we have some visitors here from Forest Service and TVMDL. So I want you, Michael, just to kind of walk us through what building we're in and what we do here. So thank you, Michael. Welcome to our next speaker for the Women of TEEX speaker series. Welcome to the Forest Service. Welcome to TVMDL in the back and front room. And anybody else online, I love seeing people from other agencies and outside of TEEX come join us. So everybody try to meet our TVMDL guests. I'll raise your hands for a moment. Thank you. We are busy preparing for 2024 and the speaker series we have going on, so there will be more to come on that, but the planning team has been busy reaching out to speakers. If you have any ideas for speakers, please reach out to one of us. Ashley is here, Shane is here, Sarah, myself, send us an email. We're taking names now. We have two more this year. We have Dr. Kelly Miller from Texas A&M Corpus coming in November. Hers will be a coffee chat, not lunch. And then in December, we have an exciting one. We have a panel of courageous men. Scott is going to ask questions. They're going to answer them. So we're working on that plan. You'll need to be there for that. As we've been preparing and I've been thinking about introducing Dr. Swinford, there's a concept that's been kind of ringing in my mind the past couple of weeks, and it's the definition of leadership. You could say the definition of leadership is based upon title and job duties, but I'm referring to the definition that says it's influence and how you treat people and how you lead people at the end of the day. And I share that with you because as I was brainstorming, I only met Dr. Swinford this spring on one of our multiple trips down to the Capitol, working on the Keeping Texas Prepared initiative and sitting in the hallways for hours on end. We were able to discuss important things like women's fashion and the sin of high heels for all day in the Capitol. But also, I shared with her that my daughter is in microbiology major in college. I was an accounting major, and I cannot help her at all when she calls me in a panic. I have no idea. I'll let her explain what microbiology is. I'm not even going to go there. Long story short, she was willing to get on the phone with some random 20-year-old panicked college kid and give her career and college advice. And I am hugely appreciative for that positive influence, not just in her life, but in mine. But I share that because she has an awesome resume. She has a great title. She has this job that will amaze you. But she also left a positive influence on myself and my daughter. And that's kind of how I view leadership, is how do you lead someone when you leave at the end of the day. So thank you, Dr. Swinford, for showing kindness and humility. Let me share a little bit about her background. Dr. Swinford assumed the role of agency director in 2021 after serving as the associate agency director since 2015. Prior to her role as associate agency director, she was the microbiology branch chief and bacteriology section head at the College Station Laboratory. As agency director, she's responsible for the executive operations of the agency, focusing on day-to-day management of the four laboratory locations. She also oversees the agency's quality assurance program and provides leadership to TVMDL's three resident directors located at the agency's other laboratory locations in Canyon, Center, and Gonzales. Dr. Swinford earned multiple degrees from the University of Illinois, two bachelor's degrees, a master's degree in veterinary pathobiology, and a doctorate in veterinary medicine. She became a diplomate of the American College of Veterinary Microbiologists in 1997. And in 2012, was elected to the organization's Board of Governors. She began her veterinary career in Nebraska, where she worked at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln's Veterinary Diagnostic Center, held positions with two veterinary biopharmaceutical companies, and served in the United States Air Force Reserve as a public health officer. In 2005, she was hired as the bacteriology section head at TVMDL here in College Station. She was promoted to branch chief in 2012, a position in which she oversaw the bacteriology, molecular diagnostics, serology, and virology section. That's a mouthful. She lives on a small acreage in South College Station with her husband, Rod, a crazy Jack Russell Terrier, a cat, three horses. In her spare time, she enjoys walking her dog, learning bluegrass mandolin, trying to grow or at least not kill orchids, and bird watching in the backyard. She's fascinated with the hummingbird migration. A few weeks ago, she gave a few of us a tour of the lab just up the road at TVMDL, and I was just reminiscing with the TVMDL folks down here. I was so hungry because that meeting ran from 11 to 12 or something. We go on the tour of the lab, which was fascinating. Wasn't hungry anymore. Thank you for the tour as well. And let's give her a welcome to TEEX.
Well, Hi. Well, that was a very gracious introduction, Stacy. Thank you, and I thoroughly enjoyed meeting and I didn't meet her daughter actually, but I talked with her on the phone. It's a very, very nice conversation. So we have a lot to talk about. I was happy to help. And Bob, I'm so honored to be part of the speaker series. I wouldn't have my name on the same slide as the TEEX name. It's quite an honor. I'm really impressed with the work that you guys do. And I've got to learn a lot more about that since I did spend time with your director of the legislature this year. So thank you for everything you do for citizens of Texas and for your agency. I've already tipped my hand to where I'm coming from here. I'm a diagonal introvert, so how many people have taken the Myers-Briggs personality? Quite a few folks. It's pretty standard for them.
All right. Pretty standard for work organizations to give that. So how many people identified as introverts on that? A number. So they say anywhere from a third to almost half the population are introverts, but I grew up thinking there was something really wrong with me because our whole culture is designed for extroverts. So for you extroverts out there, I'm happy for you, but it's a struggle for the rest of us a lot of the time. And so public speaking is not my comfort zone. Like I'd much rather be home. I'm glad to be speaking to y'all, don't get me wrong, but I'd rather be at home watching my hummingbirds outside in the feeders. So why did I agree to do this? Well, I think it's good for all of us to occasionally get outside of our comfort zones. You know, extroverts have comfort zones too that you like to stay in, and it's a real challenge sometimes to do something different. I hope that I'll be able to share some of the lessons that I've learned over the years and how I do that and how I'm making this job work for me, even though I think as an introvert, it's not an obvious position. So I'm going to start out talking about TVMDL, which I can talk about our agency all day long. That's my comfort zone to talk about that and give you a little bit of insight into our role in what would be a disaster, an animal outbreak disaster response. And then, because I have to, because this is part of this series, I'll talk about my journey and can't get out of that. So, I can't tell where to look. I have so many places that I can. All right, so a little bit about TVMDL. We are, I would say, probably the smallest agency of Texas A&M. You know, we have 8 agencies. There's only about 165 of us folks at TVMDL. And probably we're one of the least understood, unless you've happened to have used us as a customer. Anybody know if they've ever had an animal sample submitted to TVMDL? I see one person raise their hand. So, okay, so a few of you. But a lot of the citizens of Texas don't know we exist, or even some of the people in the A&M system. But we're the only state agency dedicated to providing veterinary diagnostic services to the citizens of Texas. So for example, if you have a dog and it's got an ear infection, you take it to your veterinarian and they want to know what's causing that infection. Chances are they may send that to us and we would do the culture, try to determine what's growing and tell that veterinarian how to treat it. So that's a simple example of one thing that we do. But equally important is the fact that we provide a surveillance system across the state looking for these diseases that we call diseases of high consequence. So I've just listed some of them up there, but there's many others. And so by our testing, we're, you know, kind of surveying the landscape, and occasionally these things pop up and they have to be responded to. We do have biosafety level 3 laboratories. So those are higher containment level laboratories in our lab here in College Station and also out in Canyon. And we've got those in case, you know, we come across one of these diseases and they need to be handled with high containment. So the other thing that we do is perform drug testing for racing animals and for livestock shows. And there's quite a few of those going on in the state here. And we have contracts with all the major livestock shows really across the country. So we have multiple locations. College Station is obviously the headquarters. We've got about 100 folks here. And then we have two poultry laboratories. They just do poultry testing. They're very small, with five folks up in Center and four down in Gonzales. And then this is a kind of an old picture, but the laboratory was for many years in Amarillo, and in 2020 was relocated to the campus of West Texas A&M in Canyon, which is about 12 miles south of there. Anyway, our staff, we've got over 30 professional staff that hold either a veterinary degree with some combination of advanced training, like a PhD, a master's degree. There's 18 of us that have board certifications. Tracy mentioned mine is in the College of Veterinary Microbiology, but we have pathologists as well as some folks that have preventive medicine board certification. And so these locations for TVMDL were established to be strategically placed where the animal industries would need those throughout the state of Texas. These are all the disciplines or the scientific areas that we have. We call them testing sections within the laboratory. And what I love about this is if you send a sample into TVMDL, or say you submit an animal, say, you know, an animal has died, we have all of these services available to us to work together to try to find an answer for our clients. For example, when I used to work in the bacteriology lab, I would get calls and people would want to consult with the findings that we had if we cultured a tissue or a swab that they sent in from an animal. And I could tell them what I was growing in the bacteriology laboratory, but then I would find out, usually this is a conversation with a vet, I'd find out that they had also submitted a sample to another laboratory to have the pathology read. And of course, being in another laboratory, I didn't have access to those results. And I would try to gently tell them, well, next time it might be more useful if you could send all the samples to us, we can do everything. And I can walk down the hall and talk to the pathologist and I can say, hey, I've got this thing growing on the plate. What are you seeing on your histopath slides? Does that correlate, or you know, do you think this is significant? And I can't do that when they send, you know, things to other laboratories and I don't have those results. So our sections work really well together, trying to get answers for our clients. Our clientele is pretty diverse. For one thing, there are other states that don't allow an animal owner to submit samples to them directly. They have to be working through a veterinarian. We will take samples from animal owners, livestock producers, whether or not they're working through a vet. We do work with a large number of veterinarians who are submitting samples on behalf of their clients, but that's not a requirement. We also work with other laboratories, whether they're private commercial labs, state diagnostic laboratories. We run a lot of tests that other labs don't offer. We've got almost 700 different tests in our testing catalog. So chances are we've got a test that we run that many other labs don't run, and they would send the samples here for us to run. And we also partner with a number of different state and federal agencies, such as Texas Animal Health Commission, Texas Parks and Wildlife, Texas Racing Commission, the USDA. So all those different folks are clients of ours. I like to show this slide. It's just a good snapshot of our year in review. So we run over a million tests per year. That's all of our locations together. We serve over 6,000 different clients. You can see most of our caseload comes from within Texas, but we do get samples from all 50 states. It's a little heat map of where samples come from, as well as at least 16 different countries. And then you can see the breakdown of species that we work on. So dogs and cats, this being Texas cattle, is obviously huge here, as well as poultry, horses, deer, and then everything else is in the other category. Have you heard of this thing called keeping Texas prepared? Okay, I think you probably have by now. I know you have. We were privileged to be a part of this. I just can't say enough about our fellow agencies. This was a stroke of genius. I was told by the chancellor to package all of us agencies together and go over to the legislature and advocate kind of with one voice, if you will, serving the needs for the citizens of Texas. So I won't go into the rest of that, but I did want to tell you where we fit into that, because it might be a little less obvious. You know, the TDEM extension, you guys and the Forest Service, I think most people understand their role in disaster response, but they may not understand where TVMDL plays a role. So as I already mentioned, we're constantly doing testing and surveilling the landscape for diseases that our first responders would need to be. We're not first responders, let me make that clear, but we would inform those that are, such as Texas Animal Health Commission. For example, if we found a disease, let's just say anthrax, because I'm going to talk about that in a minute, we would notify them immediately. They would go out to the ranch, quarantine it. They would not allow animals to leave there. They would make sure the remaining animals are vaccinated. They would make sure the dead animals are disposed of properly and determine that the outbreak is over before they would release that quarantine. So that's our role. So not only are we detecting things initially, but we are there for the duration of the outbreak. So depending on the disease and the outbreak, there's going to be continuing testing throughout the life of that outbreak to determine, you know, are the mitigation strategies effective? Has the disease spread stopped? You know, do we have it contained now, and is it over finally? So we'll be there for the duration of an outbreak. Also, you probably know a lot of the diseases that we're looking for can be zoonotic, meaning they can infect people. So we have a very strong role to play in public health. And then just like y'all, you think of disasters in terms of scope or scale. So whether they're local, state, national, or global, we think of those things too. So I decided to illustrate this. I was going to pick five diseases to talk about. Unfortunately, I decided that I could really only have time to talk about four of them. So chronic wasting disease is going to have to be a talk for another time. Mm-hmm. I could spend a whole hour just talking about that. But it is a disease that we're responding to currently. So anthrax. I think when you say the word anthrax, even civilians know the word, right? It strikes fear in the heart of many people. Caused by a bacterium, Bacillus anthracis. The scale of this one, though, you know, as scary as it sounds and is, it tends to be local. So like your 100-acre brush fire, for example. Like it pops up and it gets pounced upon by Texas Animal Health Commission. They respond to it, tamp it down, and then it goes away for a while. Unfortunately, though, it is zoonotic, so people can get this. That's why it's very important for us to know when it's out there. And it is endemic really throughout Texas, but we primarily see it in the, let's see if this pointer works, kind of in this region of the state mostly. We see it every year. We've been seeing it lately up in the Panhandle region. Our Canyon Laboratory has gotten some positive cases. So it's nothing new to us. It's not a thing to freak out over. We just deal with it. There are other states in the United States that see anthrax. Not many, though. You know, when I came from Illinois, we don't see anthrax there. But South Dakota sees it from time to time. I talked to the legislature about this case because it was a little bit unusual, and it illustrated why it's so important that TVMDL maintain the expertise in the laboratory to know we got to be thinking about things that could be out there even when the submitting veterinarian or the owner isn't thinking of those things. So this was a case of that in which a rancher had a couple of cattle die, didn't think much of it, cattle die all the time. He buried those. And then the third one, he found sick. So he wanted to see if that one could be saved. So they took it to the local veterinary clinic. And the vet clinic tried to treat it, and it died within a few hours. So then they sent it to us in Amarillo. That was when our lab was still in Amarillo at that time. And the veterinarian submitting this preliminarily diagnosed it as blackleg, which is another bacterial disease which can kill animals very quickly. You know, they go from looking perfectly healthy one day to you find them dead the next day. Anthrax can do the same thing. So that was his diagnosis. However, we had a microbiologist in that laboratory who actually just retired last year with 40 years working for TVMDL. He thought to himself, I better rule out anthrax and do a culture and just make sure that's not what we're dealing with. And you guessed it. That's exactly what that cow ended up having. Not only that one, but others still at the ranch. So we, of course, alerted Texas Animal Health Commission. They went out and it ended up being an outbreak that spread across four different ranches over two counties. There were untold numbers of cattle that had died by the time this outbreak was over. There is a vaccine for it, by the way. So once you know that you have it in your herd, if you can get the other ones vaccinated quickly enough, you can save them. And they can be sometimes treated with antibiotics if they haven't been infected yet. But there were also nine humans that were put on prophylactic antibiotic treatment. So it was good that we found this and stopped it. That disease had not been seen in those counties in over 30 years. So that's why that veterinarian didn't even think about anthrax, but our guy did think about it because he'd seen it before. So that's why we need to have people in our labs that can be thinking about those things, even when the submitter is not thinking of them. And I thought the legislature needed to hear about that. Who remembers Amerithrax, the Amerithrax attacks? Yeah, this, I could study this stuff all day long. it's scary and horrible. And the week after the September 11th attacks, you know, that we just observed that anniversary 22 years ago yesterday, back in 2001, a week after that, somebody sent five letters to the U.S. Postal Service that were laced with purified anthrax. They sent them to some news outlets, NBC, ABC, CBS, the National Enquirer. And the first person to contract anthrax and end up dying of it was a fellow that worked in the newsroom of the Sun, I believe, the tabloid. So, of course, this created a big scare. And then 3 weeks later, somebody sent some more letters through the U.S. Postal Service. And these were intercepted at the Capitol. A letter went to Senator Tom Daschle. A staffer of his opened that letter and was exposed to it. Well, that put the entire Capitol mailroom into lockdown. They confiscated all the mail. Ended up collecting 280, you can see that in the bottom there, 280 55-gallon drums were taken with unopened mail to a warehouse in Virginia where people donned biohazard suits to be able to go through that mail and test the rest of it. And they came up with this additional letter that was sent to Senator Patrick Leahy. Fortunately, it was opened in the biosafety cabinet, so no one was exposed to that one. And I know you can't read it, but I'll read it to you. It says, "You cannot stop us. We have this anthrax. You die now. Are you afraid? Death to America. Death to America. Allah is great." So they did behavioral and linguistics analysis of all of these letters. They determined they were probably written by the same person. It was probably an adult male. Obviously, from the context of this letter, he was taking advantage of the attacks that had just happened that were perpetrated by people outside this country. But it resulted in one of the largest and most complex investigations in the history of law enforcement. It went on for basically 10 years. And in 2008, the FBI and the Department of Justice were ready to bring charges against an individual who was a US bioterrorism researcher in one of the government facilities that would have had access to this anthrax, and he committed suicide before they could bring charges. So it's never completely been resolved. They obviously felt that he was the perpetrator, but he was never charged. Ultimately, five people died. They were just ordinary citizens. Well, I think a couple of them were mail workers, postal workers, but one was the last victim to die was an elderly, like 94-year-old woman that just got her mail out of her mailbox and was exposed to anthrax. So innocent people died. I think 17 other people were very seriously sickened by this. That's the story that's well known. What is lesser known, I'd like to share with you today, is this particular strain of anthrax was called the Ames strain. And the reason it's called the Ames strain is because it had been sent years ago to the U.S. Army Medical Research Institute of Infectious Disease, or U.S. AMRID. Maybe some of you have heard that, out in Maryland. Well, it was sent by the National Veterinary Services Laboratories, which is our reference laboratories in Ames, Iowa. And someone saw the shipping container said Ames on the return label, and they called it the Ames strain. But this strain actually came from TVMDL back in 1981. We got a cow sample from South Texas, that area that I showed you before, submitted to us by a veterinarian who still to this day submits us samples. And it was a routine isolation, but back in that day, we routinely sent things for confirmation to Ames, Iowa, and then the researchers, you know, like to have those anthrax samples shared with them, so it went on to U.S. AMRID, but that strain that killed those people actually came from South Texas. When I got to TVMDL as a section head, I inherited a box of files that had been documents gathered up for when the FBI came down and interviewed people about this, the director that hired me. So I had that box of documents in my office for a long time. And when we would get isolations in the lab, until fairly recently, I would ship those to the CDC because there were researchers there that continued to do research on anthrax and published a couple of papers with those folks. And one of those papers said, there's really nothing unique or unusual about this particular strain. It wasn't particularly virulent because we would isolate many different anthrax strains out of South Texas that looked kind of just like it. So bottom line, it wasn't especially dangerous. However, it got into the hands of somebody that knew how to purify it, you know, and use it as a weapon. That's not the form we see it in the lab. Fortunately, I mean, we're dealing with live anthrax, but it's on these plates. I took a picture of that one in the center. And while we work with it in containment and biosafety cabinet, we wear, you know, protective equipment, and I'm not particularly afraid of it in that form. So I thought you'd find that interesting, but I digress. All right, the next disease I want to talk to you about is highly pathogenic avian influenza, or HPAI. Did anyone notice that the price of poultry kind of got a little crazy last year? Yeah. So this is one reason why this disease caused by a virus. Of course, we get influenza viruses, so do chickens and turkeys. Many other animals get their own. It was already of a global scale outbreak by the time it arrived in the US in 2022. It can be zoonotic, so that's why people that study influenza follow these things very closely, because they can mutate. And, you know, some people predict our next big pandemic is going to be of influenza. And unfortunately, it's endemic in Texas and really throughout the country now. Normally, in a normal year, well, I don't think we ever have normal times anymore, but these viruses, and by the way, there are low pathogenic avian influenza viruses that are circulating all the time. They don't kill chickens. High path AI, the first sign you normally see is dead birds. That's it. It just kills them within hours. But in previous outbreaks, these strains would die off in the summertime. So when the temperatures would go up, it would basically kill off the virus and then we'd be free of the disease. And that did not happen this year. So unfortunately, we're coming to the conclusion that we're living with this. And now I just briefly need to mention to you that we're part of this, what's called the National Animal Health Laboratory Network. So it's a network nationwide of publicly funded state laboratories like ourselves. And we get activated when there is an outbreak, particularly regionally or certainly nationally. And that's what happened in this case. So the picture on, let's see, your left, I don't know if you can read that, from March 23, 2022. That was early on in this outbreak. We had seen it first in South Carolina in January 2022. And then you can see in a couple of months how far it had spread. The dark red, by the way, is where it had been detected in commercial poultry labs. The pink is if it had been detected in wild birds. That little snapshot was on the USDA website the day after we first detected it here in Texas. So our laboratory in Gonzales picked it up for the first time in Texas on March 22nd. Just hadn't made it into the report yet. And then where the United States is all red is the present situation. So it's now spread across every state. It's killed close to 60 million birds, or they've been euthanized. That's the reason for the price of eggs and poultry to have gone up so much. So, and I think we're living with it now. I don't think it's going away, or at least it shows no sign of that. So here's a map of where we've found it all over Texas. Texas has been fortunate in that, unlike some of the other, particularly the Midwestern states, we have not, knock on wood, found it in commercial poultry operations. I know it says commercial pheasant flock. That met the technical definition of commercial, but it's not like your large broiler or egg producing operations. We haven't found it there yet. Those operations have done a great job of battening down the hatches. So that's another important reason why we need to be doing surveillance for this. So they know it's out there. It's spread by wild birds, and a lot of species of wild birds aren't affected by it, but they're very effective at spreading it across the landscape. And that's what's happened. So every single one of our four labs has found it by now. We also found it in a mammalian species, in a skunk, out at our Canyon laboratory. And I talked to the legislature about that too. This is, again, a concern that this virus has made the jump into many different mammalian species, foxes, bears, skunks, seals, porpoises, all kinds of different things. So they're worried that it could do that and become a human pathogen. African swine fever. Just briefly mention this. It's another virus. It's currently global in scale. It's been in Europe for a few years. It's been in Asia. This one is not zoonotic, so it only affects porcine. It will not jump into people. It's not currently endemic in Texas. It's not even in Texas at all yet, but we're worried about it because back in 2021, I believe it was found in as close as the Dominican Republic and Haiti, so it's knocking on our door. The USDA has been conducting a lot of tabletop exercises and other things for us that work in the labs to get our folks ready to be able to identify it. And the worry for Texas in particular is, look at the purple, that's your states with feral swine populations. So we're right in the bullseye. And if it comes here, it's going to be devastating, obviously, to the commercial pork industry, but I don't think we'll ever be able to get rid of it with all the feral swine that we have running around. Now, a lot of people probably would like to see the swine die off of something, African swine fever, but it's a fatal disease in them, and it would have very adverse events, effects on our commercial swine industry. And then everyone's sick of hearing about COVID, all this buzz through this, but it's another example of a disease, obviously, that jumped from animals into people. We are pretty sure it came from bats. Now, whether the bats infected a person in the wet markets in China or whether it came out of the lab, like that's a whole controversial topic in and of itself. But one way or another, it made the jump. Obviously, it's global, zoonotic, and here to stay. But it was the first time that TVMDL ever became involved in testing a disease of human, or testing human samples, I should say. So there were a number of us veterinary diagnostic labs that were kind of horrified in the early days of the outbreak at watching our human health laboratories struggle with the caseload, because they did not have the high throughput equipment that we take for granted. You know, they're used to running one sample at a time, you know, when you go to the doctor's office and get tested, not herds of people. And that's what we do, is test herds of animals and flocks, you know. So we had the PCR equipment that they lacked at that time. So we partnered with two different hospitals, one here in College Station and the other one out in Amarillo. We trained their personnel. They came in, used our equipment, our facilities, and we got this testing done. And it made a huge difference for thousands of different clients that at that time were waiting, you know, up to a week to get their test results. And that was well before the home kits were available. That concludes the interesting part of my talk. You can leave now, and I will try to take you through how I got to where I am. So I was an awkward kid. I'm just going to put it out there. A little nerd. I loved being in my books. I always had kind of a dumb look on my face, I think, in pictures. So that picture there, with my dad, and this is my little brother, Mark. He's 3 years younger than me. But I loved horses at that age, man. But we lived in the suburbs of Chicago, and my parents were, well, my dad was a school teacher, my mom was a school librarian, so there's no way I could afford a horse in the suburbs of Chicago. But I could get these rocking horses, and I rode the hell out of these things, like so much that I wore the springs out of them, and I must have had about 4 or 5, I think. And I really hadn't thought about this till I started putting this talk together, but instead of just throwing them away when I wore one out, my dad would cut its head off and put it on my bedroom wall. And I didn't think anything of it at the time. Now I think this kind of twisted, and maybe the FBI probably should have interviewed him. Actually, they did interview my dad for the Unabomber investigation. Not that they thought he was the Unabomber, but the Unabomber came from, he grew up in an area where my dad taught, and so he got an interview from the FBI. But anyway, that's what he did to my little horses. The other picture, I really can't explain. That's me with my face planted in, I think, a bowl of water. But this is kind of a family favorite photo for the look on my other brother's face. So this is my youngest brother, Emerson. He's 6 years younger than me. And I mean, I just imagine looking at my mom going like, really? Like, is she supposed to be doing that? So I would say this was maybe the first time that a subordinate challenged my leadership skills, but certainly not the last. So as I mentioned, I loved animals, all kinds of animals, so maybe it was inevitable that I was going to go to vet school. However, I didn't go directly to vet school. Let me tell you why. I did enroll in the College of Agriculture at University of Illinois in the pre-vet curriculum, thought that that's what I wanted to do. But as part of that curriculum, I had to take an intro to microbiology course, and man, it just like knocked my socks off. I was just in love with microbiology, and especially like being able to diagnose, I don't know how many of you have taken a micro class, but just working up an unknown. So they give you a plate of bacteria and you're supposed to figure out what it is, and using those little test kits, like that's what I thought I wanted to do, was design those test kits that could give you an answer what a particular organism was. So I dropped out of the College of Ag and I enrolled in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences to major in microbiology, and that's what I got my bachelor's in. So I graduated with that, but I was super burned out from school at that point. Like if you had told me I was going to go on and get two more degrees, I would have said, you are crazy. I'm not ever going to any more college. So I stayed in town there. I worked at a job. I actually happened to have a job when I was a student washing dishes in a physics laboratory, which was science. So I took a job, a full-time job after I graduated and did that for a couple of years. But I started to get an itch and, you know, want to get back to what I was really interested in doing. So I decided to go back and work on a master's degree. And I did that at the College of Veterinary Medicine there in at University of Illinois. And it was there I taught, so I had a teaching stipend teaching the veterinary students. And it was team taught. There was about six of us. And a few of those folks already had their DVMs and they were working on their PhD. And I thought, that's what I want to do. Like they have the understanding of the host side. So they have the medicine side. You know, right now I just know the bug side. I want both. I want an understanding of the host's response to the pathogen. So I thought, all right, I'm going to go to vet school. So I enrolled in vet school and I actually worked on my master's during that time. So I would, it's kind of cumbersome that I would have to drop out of graduate school during the school year to enroll in vet school. And then in the summer, I would drop out of vet school. I mean, they couldn't figure out, I guess, how to do that concurrently. Anyway, I got at University of Illinois, basically having my master's and my DVM about the same time. I just still had to write my thesis and defend that. So I've had the opportunity to mentor veterinary students and some veterinarians that are early career. And I feel like they're afraid they're going to make a mistake. They're afraid they're going to take a wrong job or, you know, take a wrong turn. I never really felt that way or I don't remember feeling that way. I mean, I just took a job that was interesting to me at the time. But I used to tell people, or I still do, like, you really can't screw this up unless you just aren't paying any attention. But take a job if you think it's something you like, and you'll learn something from every job, even if it's not ultimately what you end up doing. I think it's really important, especially when you're young, to figure out as much what you don't like doing as what you do like doing. So anyway, when I graduated my DVM, there was this job in Nebraska working at the university there at their diagnostic lab. And it was like my dream job. Like it at that time, the U.S. was trying to eradicate a disease in swine called pseudorabies virus. And I had worked on that for my master's degree. So this job was like written for me. So I took it. There's just one catch. It came with supervising people. But, you know, at that stage, I was like, well, how hard could it be? I mean, I bossed my brothers around for years and that seemed to go okay. So I didn't think anything about that aspect of it. Turns out supervising people is a little harder than you would think it would be, as I came to find out. But I took advantage of UNL. They had some, like, you know, introductory supervision classes, and I took whatever was there. And I'd also, in vet school, they had a class for us when we were freshmen called, like, Alternatives to Practice. And I loved that class because I never really wanted to go to vet school to be a, like, cat and dog doctor, just do the routine stuff. But one of the people that came to talk to us was from the military, and I was like, I like what the veterinarians do in the military, but for personal reasons, I couldn't go active duty. So this reserve job came up, and veterinarians in the Air Force are public health officers. The veterinarians that treat animals have largely been relegated to the Army now, but public health officer was interesting to me because it was preparing troops for what disease threats in theater they might be encountering, ensuring that the chow halls were, the food was, you know, safe to eat, and the barber shops were sanitary, things like that. So I took that job. So it was that typical 1 weekend a month, two weeks a year. And really, I ended up doing all my training here in Texas. So that was probably a good thing, because as you'll see later, I ended up here, right? But that picture there was part of a C-130. We were getting ready to deploy down to Wichita Falls. So I was assigned to the 710th Medical Squadron, attached to Offutt Air Force Base there in Nebraska and Omaha. And we're like a 50-bed air transportable hospital. You guys probably know a lot about these things, but it's kind of like the MASH unit that the Air Force has. So we had to train to set up these hospitals out in the field. So that's what we did in this exercise in Wichita Falls in the summer, wearing neoprene chem suits. It was very hot, foreshadowing of my life here now, I think. My troops there, so again, here's supervision of people. I would say I'd been doing enough of it in my civilian job that it didn't faze me, but you know, I didn't take the job to necessarily go into personnel management or anything. But they were a great group of people to work with. We had to do exercises in which the scenario was there's a chemical attack. So one of my people had to break the seal on their gas mask, and if they died, then you know, we knew that there was a nerve agent or whatever out there. That was the exercise. So they were a lot of fun. Anyway, I really enjoyed that. And it just so happened that both of these jobs, well, my boss there, Dr. Osario, he's very supportive of me, but he was kind of trying to kick me out of the nest at the university there and say, you can do better, go out and apply for other jobs. So I did. I got a corporate job, which I made a lot more money at, and I left at about the same time the Air Force was doing a drawdown, so they cut my slot. So I left those jobs, and the upside of it was I took a corporate job for a biopharmaceutical company, and the upside was I didn't have to manage people, so I was happy because I could just do my own work and be responsible for that. So I did that for a few years, but again, like, I got that itch of, I was working on mostly drugs, getting new drug approvals, you know, and it was interesting, but again, my interest is really in infectious disease, so I was starting to get anxious to get back to that. And this position came open at TVMDL in late 2004. It was for running the bacteriology section. And again, another dream, quote unquote, dream job. So I applied for it, I got it, and I remember thinking, well, it's your dream job, but you have to go back to supervising people. But I wanted it bad enough that I thought I can do it. So so I did that for about 10 years when Dr. Bruce Akey became our director in 2015. And he had been the, excuse me, I need to clear my throat. He'd been the lab director at Cornell and another laboratory before that. And he always said that the mistake he made was not having an associate director. So he asked me if I would like to be his associate director. And I immediately said yes. In the same conversation, though, he asked me, well, would you want to be me someday? And I said, no way. No, not going to happen. I didn't even think about it. Like, it was not my vision. I've never been somebody that really wanted to work my way up the ladder. I just kind of kept finding myself in, I guess, areas of increasing responsibility without really meaning to. So, but I was happy being his associate director, working alongside Stacy and Vic Seidel, who some of you know, that was our director's office at the time. And he announced he was going to retire in the summer of 2021. So I had a decision to make at that point because he had already recommended me to the higher ups that I could perhaps take over for him. I was still very resistant to that idea. I didn't see that for myself. I certainly didn't think I was like him, and I was happy kind of working behind the scenes and, you know, making, getting his vision executed and whatnot. Just didn't really see myself stepping into this public role. I even did at one point like a gap analysis of, I took his position description and I did an inventory of my skills and I mapped out like where I was lacking. And like, why do women do that? Right? Are we the ones that think like, oh, I don't have this, I don't have that. And sorry guys, but I think a lot of men are not like that. They think, oh, I can do that, you know, and they just assume they can figure it out on the job, and we're analyzing if we have the right stuff or not. So that was me. And I just really did not see myself stepping into this role for quite some time. I think what really changed my thought on this was realizing that I have just this amazing group of people that I've worked with for years. That would still be working with me. I assumed they wouldn't fly the coop once I took over. And they didn't. So they were, you know, there with me. And I've got a great group now of AgriLife directors and the vice chancellor who are wonderful to work with. So overall, like, it's an amazing team. And you know, I feel like when I came back to the diagnostic lab after having been in the corporate world, it was like finding my people again. I just really felt like these are the folks that I can relate to. We're all kind of a bunch of introverted nerds, I guess you would say. There's something kind of unique about us. We're a strange group, but I fit in there. I think it's important that we all have that. And it doesn't have to be at work, right? You can find that in your church or a volunteer group that you like, but everybody has to have a place where they feel like they really belong. And I'm just fortunate that I find that at work. Another thing that I've had to do is to quote unquote, get out of your head. I think most of us have heard that term before. So one thing is, to be able to find activities that you like to do that put you in that state of flow, you know, where you're not thinking about anything except doing that thing. So these are just some of the things that I like to do that when I'm doing them, I'm not thinking about TVMDL or the things that I have to get done at work or really anything else. It's just like immersive. And then you come out of that and it's like your brain has had a vacation or something. But I think that's really important. But a real breakthrough that I had was discovering mindfulness meditation. So I actually had kind of a crisis of confidence, not when I stepped into this role, but actually when I went from being the section head in the laboratory to the associate director position. It was the weirdest thing. Like I've always been very self-conscious, but this was like self-consciousness on steroids. I felt like sitting in meetings and people were staring at me and wondering like, why is she in that role? And if I opened my mouth and said something, it was really dumb. That's how I felt. Or if I didn't say anything, they were like, what value do you add? You know, these are the things I imagine people thinking. It's very almost paralyzing, I would say. So I actually went and I sought out EAP. I talked to a counselor about this for a year. That's how bad it made me feel. And she was helpful, but no real breakthroughs, I don't think, came out of that. But one day I was driving home and I like to listen to National Public Radio's Fresh Air. I don't know if you guys listen to that, but she was interviewing a man named Dan Harris, and he had just written this book called 10% Happier. Have you heard of this? Has anyone heard of it? A few people have. So he was a ABC news journalist, former anchor man, and you know, traveled the world, was a war correspondent, type A driven personality. And he got to the point where, I mean, he had anxiety attacks and panic attacks, and I never had any of those to my knowledge, but it became paralyzing for him. And he wrote about and talked about in this interview one instance where he had a meltdown on live national television. You can pull it up on YouTube, and I've gone and looked. It's not as, I think, dramatic as what he probably felt like it was, but you could see he was like having a deer in the headlights moment on national television. So when that happened to him, he knew, like, I need help. So he explored a number of different things, but one of the things that he explored was mindfulness meditation. And he was a skeptic at first and writes about that in the book, but he became so convinced, and there's a lot of science behind it. And, you know, they've used it in schools, they've used it in prisons now, but in this training of the mind, that he eventually left news journalism and he launched this 10% happier podcast, and there's an app. So it has guided meditations, but the podcast is interviewing, you know, interesting people. Like this week they're doing, or the last couple of weeks they've been doing a series on work. They've done one on sleep and on physical activities. They'll talk to, you know, famous celebrities. It's not all about mindfulness necessarily, but it's about managing life. He calls it 10% happier because he kind of undersells it's not necessarily going to change your life, but it did change my life. I have to say, I use mindfulness meditation most mornings before I go to work. It really puts me in a good mind state. And I have a great example of what it does. So a couple of weeks ago, there were a few of us driving over to Austin for a meeting, and I had to be at the lab early. So I didn't have time to do this that morning. I may or may not have run a red light on the way to the lab that morning, and I could have possibly cursed a couple of people on the way to the lab. I felt very stressed out. And then the next day, it was back to my normal routine, and I did my meditation. And I mean, I was so zen. Like, anything could have happened on the way to work, and I would have been fine with it. So it just, like, it really puts me in a different mental state. The other thing it's helped me with is kind of the imposter syndrome. I think we've talked about this in the series before. Like, so when you do mindfulness meditation, you know, basically, I'll do a terrible job of explaining it, but your mind is like the sky, and your thoughts are like clouds just passing through. And so you are not your thoughts. Your thoughts are there, but they're not going to be there forever, right? Just like clouds, they come and go. So, you know, these thoughts of imposter syndrome, they're not necessarily real. They're just thoughts, right? And your thoughts are not you. So just having that separation, and for me being able to step back and think about these, some of these things that I thought about myself, they're really self-critical. I think, is that really true? Or is that just a thought that's passing through your head? So anyway, don't want to get too much farther into that, but it really has made a huge difference for me. This is fairly self-explanatory, but I use these two fellows. I think that most of you probably know the one there on your left, Mr. Al Davis. Some of you have worked with him. I know he was here at TEEX for many, many years. He was at TEEX, I think, as long as I've been at, or almost as long as I've been at TVMDL. So, and I knew. Now, he told me he wouldn't be here today, but I knew if I showed a picture of him, he would want it to be in his sweet Corvettes. Al and I actually got to know each other pretty well, driving over to the legislature together a few times, and we have a surprising number of things in common. And I also have a lot of things in common with my former boss, Dr. Bruce Akey. But if I were to try to do things the way either one of these guys do them, I would fail. And I actually did try to do something the same as what I thought Dr. Akey would do. So one day he sent me over when I was his associate director to fill in for him to give an update to a board of directors meeting. And I've never seen him prepare for a talk or get nervous about talking to people. So I thought, well, that's what I need to be able to do, just stand up, spontaneously talk about TVMDL without any preparation. It did not go well. I mean, that's really actually the thing that sent me to the counselor. Like, I got back from that and I was freaked out. I was like, I suck. Like, I am just terrible. terrible human being. I need help. And, you know, I was trying to be somebody that I'm not. Similarly with Al, Al freaks me out every time I see them do this, but he would be writing out the comments for his remarks, like as we are literally sitting there getting ready to be called up to the lectern at the legislature or at the AgriLife conference or at the Board of Regents. Like he's sitting there writing his notes out. And the first time I saw him do that, I thought, oh God, Al, like, it was like watching somebody on a high wire act to me. They're like, he's going to like fall. It's going to be terrible. And you know, he knocks it out of the park every time. Like he is such an amazing speaker and advocate. And I can't do that. Like, look at this. I have 7 pages of notes. And I put so many hours into this talk. Why am I ashamed to share that? Like, I'm almost embarrassed to tell you that. Why? Because I care about this talk. I put a lot of work into it, but I think our culture really admires people that can just like, oh, just jump up on stage and take the mic and be amazing. And that's not me. So I know what my strengths are, and that's not one of them. So I play to my strengths and I minimize my weaknesses. And I know to get up here, I have to prepare a lot. So just sharing that with you. At the end of the day, you know, I really got over myself in this position because I realized it's really not about me. Then I say, and it is, and I'll explain that. So being the director of an agency is really just representing the agency. I realized like, it's not going to be about you, Amy. It's going to be about, the focus is going to be on your agency and how well you carry, or how well the agency is carrying out its mission for the citizens of Texas. So once I realized that and the opportunity to represent our employees, like I really kind of got over myself. I like that in our hallways, in some of our hallways, we have a nod to history. And that one shadow box there is, we came across this and when we moved to our new building in 2017, we found the very first submission to TVMDL back in 1969. So somebody had kept that all those years. That was back when we kept a log of our records on paper. Now, of course, everything's computerized, but that's pretty cool. And then the center is our plaque with all of our employees that have retired. I think there's 94 names up there. So, you know, I think it's really important to remember that you're carrying on, you owe it to these people that dedicated, you know, probably most of their lives to the mission of this agency, and you owe it to them to continue to make sure that the reputation of our agency is proud and untarnished. And of course, there's many other people that didn't have the, for whatever reason, ability to make TVMDL their last place of employment, but that their work was equally important. So they're not represented there. And then we have a hallway of our previous directors. And while each of them, you know, was unique and left a lasting mark on the agency, again, they're just one person. And behind each of them was all of these employees that were working for the agency kind of behind the scenes. So that's why I say it's not about me. But then it also is, because looking at those directors, I know that eventually I will be replaced by someone. We've learned recently we're all replaceable, right? So, but I try not to get my identity too wrapped up in whatever job title I have or position. I think it's really important to see yourself as a person of value outside of your job, and just not get too attached to that. So what happened to these three little kids that I started out talking about? My brother Mark was 3 years younger than me, ended up being an aeronautical engineer. He went on to invent a riveter, and created his own company selling those things to like Boeing and General Electric and General Motors. So he became an inventor as well. My youngest brother, Emerson, he was a child that never had, he was never without a guitar in his hand, literally never. So he's been a professional musician. He's been Rod Stewart's guitarist for the last 10 years. They just finished up their US summer tour. And I think they're gonna be in Las Vegas. Rod has a residency at Caesar's Palace, and you can catch them there if you want to go to Las Vegas. As for me, you know what happened to me, but this has just been an amazing ride that I would have missed out on if I hadn't said yes to being director. So riding in the grand entry at the Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo, getting to testify at the legislature is a tremendous privilege. How many people get to do that? And then occasionally riding in the system jet. Only time I've ever been on a private jet. It's pretty easy to get used to traveling like that, I want to tell you. And then this talk would not be complete without me acknowledging my true partner in life, Rod Lemberg. I literally met Rod the day that I came back from Texas back to Nebraska with a job offer in hand, and he called me for a date, and I said, well, I don't want to waste your time. I'm moving to Texas. And he said, well, there's nothing keeping me here. And I thought, how presumptuous of you. We went out on a date and kind of love at first sight. And he followed me to Texas a few months later. So I started working at TVMDL in February of 2005. And he drove down a few months later, and lo and behold, a job opened up at TVMDL that was perfect for him. And of course, you know, I wasn't the director then, so I had nothing to do with his hiring, and he had to go through the interview process fair and square. There was, I think, four other applicants, but they gave him the job. He's worked there ever since. So he does an amazing job for the agency. He just received the Dr. Sable congratulating him. He received the Vice Chancellor's Award in Excellence in January for the work that he does for the agency. But beyond that, he is a tremendous supporter of me, always has been. He takes great care of all of our animals and our property. He's always up for whatever crazy madcap scheme I have going, like here rescuing these orchids from Lowe's clearance during the pandemic when we all had to wear masks back then. So can't say enough about, I couldn't literally do what I do without him. So I will leave you with this. I don't know how many folks read this book when it came out. I really liked it. Written by Sheryl Sandberg, who was at that time the chief operating officer of what was called Facebook then. Now I think it's Meta. But she had a lot of really great inspirational messages for women in the workplace. And I really can't say it better than her, so I'm just going to read this quote. Fear is at the root of so many barriers that women face. Fear of not being liked, fear of making the wrong choice, fear of drawing negative attention, fear of overreaching, fear of being judged, fear of failure. And the holy trinity of fear, the fear of being a bad mother, wife, daughter. Without fear, women can pursue professional success and personal fulfillment and freely choose one or the other or both. So that quote is in right up front, the first chapter called The Leadership Ambition Gap. What would you do if you weren't afraid? So, you know what I've done, and now I get to ask you, what would you do if you weren't afraid? Thank you for spending your lunch hour with me.
Any questions? Yeah, talk loud. Okay. Going back to the topic or whatever, it was kind of the same role that was the impact on the political ranges. We are able to kind of determine or figure out what causes the effect of 4 inches in the like water source, whether it's leaving or.
That's the thing about anthrax. The spores from that bacteria exist in the soil. They're very hardy, so they can be there literally for decades under the surface of the soil. And a lot of times, and so somebody may not know that they've had a case of anthrax on their ranch until maybe perhaps, and I don't remember the weather conditions at the time, but a typical scenario is we'll have a heavy rain. This happens a lot in South Texas, and the rain will bring those spores up to the surface, and they will get on the blades of grass, and then the cattle will eat them and then die of anthrax by ingesting it. So it's usually something like that. It's been there for a long, long time. A lot of times a ranch will change hands and that new ranch owner won't realize that they had a outbreak of anthrax years ago. They won't vaccinate their animals. And then they find out the hard way that they've got anthrax on the ranch. So, but good question. Thank you.
You mentioned being the smallest agency. Is that by design, by choice, by necessity?
That's a good question. I never really thought about it. I think it's just that's how many people we need to do the work that we do. We've been that same number for many, many years. It's in our bill pattern. It's not.
That's enough.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't always have those poultry labs. Those were added to us back in the 90s. Certainly the Amarillo lab was added 6 years after the College Station. So I think there was some recognition that, you know, there needed to be some regionality to the lab. But as far as how many people in each lab, it's just, we've always really had just the bare minimum to get the job done. That's how we always feel. Maybe you guys feel the same way, but it's just enough, not too much. So.
How does your surveillance program deal with the southern border? And do you have surveillance or liaison into Mexico, since their animals will affect Texas animals?
Animals being imported across the border have to come with a health certificate. So testing has to be done somewhere. We don't do testing for those animals, or not necessarily. They could come to Texas, and maybe some of them have. I don't know on each individual case, but they've got to pass the inspection. They need to have a health certificate and be declared free of certain diseases that we want to keep out. So, and that's true of any, you know, not just the Mexico border, but if they come in overseas or whatever. I mean, the importation of animals requires laboratory testing be done by somebody. Yes.
Yes, let me ask you, what is your NVTI type?
ISTJ. Yeah. But off the scale introvert. I used to think, you know, I'd get better, like introversion would be something you could improve upon. And every time I've taken it, I'm just as introverted as I ever was. So even though I can get up here and speak, it doesn't mean I'm not an introvert. I'm still an introvert. So.
Did you ever in your self-talk that you, when you seek your own self-talk role, I mean, what shook your confidence? Was it self-competency, or was it just something that you had applied for to continue to be successful?
What did you say? What male? Did you say male dominant?
Like, were you working around a lot of males?
That's what I thought. Yeah. No, I can't blame it on anyone other than my own personal hangups. Certainly, I don't think my family. Maybe I don't know. It's from within me, but I could never blame it. I've been blessed throughout my career. I've never worked with anyone that made me feel bad about myself. It was me making me feel bad about myself. So,
any other questions? I will add that I have sat next to Al in the Capitol, and I've seen him making those last minute notes, and I can't even read his handwriting. But yet he knocks it out of the park.
He does. Yeah. I It works for him, right? I mean, he must use the adrenaline and
He also has really nice videos he's working with.
Oh, yeah, I know. We always struggle to compare to the Forest Service. I've always hated going after them in the bill pattern. It's just hard to compete with things on fire, but we've done our best. And I try to paint a really kind of ghoulish picture. I've even been told by Leyland Folk, I'm like, okay, that's enough of that, you know, gloom and doom. Let's go, you know, but I mean, that's the nature of our work. Like, animals die, you know, I don't like it either, but it's why it's so important what we do, right? To try to minimize that. So thank you for your attention. It's been a pleasure.
Feel that for me for a second. So we always kind of like to do a little wrap up and, you know, some of the great takeaways that we got from our speakers. And I just wanted to say, first of all, you're very funny. So don't sell yourself for an honor. And thank you for all that you do for not only for people, but also all the animals in Texas and in the other states. Greatly appreciate it. It's very important what you do. I thought growing up also microbiology was like my favorite class that I ever took, so I would love to ask you like a bunch of questions later. And also my husband's from Amarillo, and I also just got my first hummingbird here, so we could talk about all those things separately. But no, I thought you had some great things to offer. One of the things you said was when you're passionate about something that you will always find a way to do it. I kind of feel like, but every person's path is different, and you got to figure out your own way. Learn something from every job. I think that's such a great lesson in life, because sometimes we're not always open to it if we feel like it's not something that we really want to do, but there's always an opportunity for growth. Sometimes you have to do things that are uncomfortable, but it often leads to greater things. And your thoughts are not you. Don't overanalyze what you lack, but focus on your strengths. Working with amazing people and people you really enjoy should also be really treasured. That's not always the case, so I appreciate that as well. And find things to do to give yourself a mental break. We all know how important that is. So, you know, find some time to take a load off. Anyway, thank you very much, Dr. Swinford. We appreciate you.